So hey guys, welcome to 4Pi Academy. This is Ankita Rajput and this class is basically for classical mechanics. And in this class, today we will discuss about the very important topics of classical mechanics and also about the most important topics of classical mechanics, okay, on the basis of NET and GATE examination. And before that, we will also discuss a little bit about the pattern of these examinations, CSIR NET examination and GATE examination, okay? So guys, I want to tell you one thing that we as a team 4Pi Academy, okay? So we have started our online batch for the preparation of these examination, NET and GATE examination, and classes are already going on. So if anyone joined two classes, so you can join, okay? So it's a 2-month course. So for this course, the fee is 5,000 rupees. So if anyone interested, you can contact us anytime. Okay, and apart from this, we have also previous, we can say pre-recorded videos as well. So you can also avail these videos, okay? And in this course, we will also cover all the topics, okay? All the papers of physics and also aptitude part. Okay, which is also important in NET and GATE examination. So for pre-recorded videos, the total fees is 4,000 rupees. Okay, so if anyone wants to know about the course pattern, sample courses, sample videos, so you can contact us. Okay, so now we will start our classical mechanics. Okay. Okay guys, so little bit about the pattern of the examination I want to tell you. So in CSIR NET examination, there are 9 papers of physics, okay, plus general aptitude section, okay. So these are the 9 papers: mathematical physics, classical mechanics, quantum mechanics, electromagnetic theory, thermodynamics and statistical physics, atomic and molecular physics, nuclear and particle physics, condensed matter physics, and electronics in experimental methods. So these are the papers, okay, in NET examination and GATE examination. So you will get questions from all these papers, okay? And this is the pattern of NET examination, okay? So in NET, you have 3 parts, part A, part B, and part C. So in part A, you will have total 20 questions, okay? And this part is basically from the general aptitude section, okay? So from 20 questions, the maximum questions to be answered are 15 only, okay? And for each right answer, you can get 2 marks and negative marking is 25%, okay? For part B and part C, these 2 parts are from your core subject physics, okay? So there is a different syllabus for both part B and part C. And in part B, you will have maximum 25 questions and you have to answer only 20 questions, okay? For each correct answer, 3.5 marks you will get, and negative marking is same for all the sections, that is 25%. Part C is also from core subject physics and total number of questions here are 30 and you have to answer maximum 20 questions and you will get 5 marks, okay? So it's the most scoring section of NET examination. Okay, and negative marking is 25%. So this is the pattern of your NET examination and this is a pattern of GATE examination. Okay, so in GATE examination also, you will have some questions from this section, general aptitude section. So this section is also important and you will have 2 types of questions, 1 mark and 2 mark for this section. Okay, and from your subject, your physics, you will have 2 types of questions. Multiple choice questions will be there, okay, having 1 or 2 mark, and negative marking will be 1/3 for 1 mark and 2/3 for 2 marks question, okay. And there is also some other kinds of question, numeric answer type questions, okay.
Ma'am, in GATE examination is computer based, na?
Yeah, but from last time, your NET examination is also computer based.
But ma'am, if yes. Computer-based examination, then how can we take a numerical answer? Written test is not available.
No, but you have to write. Now there is an option. You can type your answer there. Okay.
Okay. Type.
Okay, you can type. You can type. There is a virtual keyboard on the screen, so you can use that keyboard. Okay. So
okay, ma'am.
In numeric answer type questions, there is no option, so you have to give the answer, and there is no negative marking for this particular section. So this is the important things about NET examination, guys. So for NET exam examination, I want to tell you the part B and part C. Okay, in part B, in NET examination, this is quite important. Okay, so these are the 7 papers. Okay, and these 7 papers, you will get questions from this in part B. So mathematical physics, in mathematical physics, total number of questions in part B will be 4 to 5. So you can choose accordingly. Means if you think that some paper is not suit you, means you are weak in particular paper, so you can decide according to your convenience whether you should prepare this paper or not. Okay, so in mathematical physics, there will be 4 to 5 questions, 3 to 4 questions from quantum mechanics. In classical mechanics, 3 to 5 questions. So this is the paper which we are going to cover a little bit about this paper. In electromagnetic theory, 3 to 6 questions. Okay, and electronics in 2 to 4 questions, and 2 to 5 questions you will get in from thermodynamics and statistical physics, and from experimental methods 0 to 1 questions. Okay, so this is about part B. And similarly in part C, these are the 8 papers. Okay, you have to prepare these 8 papers. Okay, for part C, so 4 to 6 questions from mathematical physics, 3 to 4 questions from quantum mechanics, 3 to 4 questions from classical mechanics, 3 to 6 questions from electromagnetic theory, for electronics 1 to 4 questions, and from thermodynamics and statistical physics 2 to 4 questions, 2 to 3 questions from condensed matter physics, or you can say solid state physics, and 4 to 7 questions from atomic and molecular physics or nuclear and particle physics. So these slides are quite important. So now this is your syllabus. This is the syllabus of classical mechanics. Okay, so classical mechanics, you will have questions in part B, also in part C, but the syllabus is quite different. Okay, so this is NET syllabus, and this is the syllabus of classical mechanics in GATE examination. Okay, so guys, syllabus is not, we can say it's not small. Okay, there are so many topics in classical mechanics. Okay, so I am going to tell you the most important topics of classical mechanics on the basis of these 2 examinations. Okay, means if you have less time and you cannot cover all the topics, all the syllabus of classical mechanics, so these are the most important and most scoring topics, I would say. So you need to prepare at least these topics, okay, at any cost. So first important thing is Lagrangian and Hamiltonian. Okay, it's very important, and different kinds of problems will be there from this topic. Central force problems, means your Kepler's laws and planetary motion, everything. Okay, so this is central force problems are very, very important. 2 body collisions, okay, in center of mass frame and in left frame, this is also important. Movement of inertia related problems, this is easy and very important. And in GATE examination, definitely you will have questions based on this moment of inertia. Okay, and small oscillations and normal modes, special theory of relativity, and also Poisson brackets. Okay, so these topics are very, very important, guys. So we will discuss today in classical mechanics these few topics. Okay, we will discuss about the stable and unstable equilibrium. Okay, frequency of small oscillations we will discuss. Then we will discuss topics from special theory of relativity, means inertial and non-inertial frames, length contraction, time dilation, and what is the principle of simultaneity. Okay, this is simultaneity. Okay, so we will discuss these topics today. So first topic is stable and unstable equilibrium. So guys, listen carefully, okay, and collect your queries. You can ask after the session. So we have equilibrium. You all know about the equilibrium, means it's the position which we can say the particle is in rest. Okay, it's the most comfortable position for the particle. And there are 2 types of equilibrium position. If you see in this graph, this is a This is the graph for your particle. Your particle is moving, suppose, in this way. But suppose if your particle is situated at this point, okay, at this point, if your particle is situated, suppose, guys, some disturbance there. Please go on mute if you don't want to ask anything. Okay. So if your particle is situated here and you displaced your particle by a small distance, okay, so what happens, this is the position. If you will displace your particle from here, the particle will go like this and it will not come back. So this is the most position of your particle. This is the most unstable position of your particle. So this position is known as unstable equilibrium. Why? Because if you will give a small disturbance to your particle, it will go far away from this point. Okay, it will not going back here. Same different case here. If your particle is situated at this location, at this position, and suppose you will disturb your particle. Okay, you will disturb your particle by a small distance like this. So the position is that the particle will come back to this point and it will start oscillating. So this is the stable equilibrium, means the particle will come back to its initial position. So this point is known as stable equilibrium. So we have two types of equilibrium, stable and unstable equilibrium. So as we have said, in stable equilibrium, this or your particle always returns to its after a small disturbance. But in the case of unstable equilibrium, the particle moves away from this position and it's known as your unstable equilibrium. Okay. So a little bit more information about your stable equilibrium, because it's quite important topic. Okay. So as we are saying that this is the stable equilibrium position for your particle. So mathematically, what you will say, this is the potential energy curve, right? This is the potential energy curve, means a curve between the potential energy and the distance. Okay. So at this point, the force is zero. Force is zero. That's why it's in equilibrium, right? So force is zero. And what is the force? F equals to minus dv over dx. It's the gradient of your potential energy. So dv over dx is also zero. And you can say the slope of potential energy curve is zero, right? The slope is zero here, guys. Okay. So this is very, very important equation. Your fx is zero, means your slope dv over dx is zero at stable equilibrium. Okay. And potential
I mean, Anwar.
Guys, please go on mute. Someone is on. Okay, I put on mute because someone is on. Okay, so at this point, potential energy is minimum. Okay, potential is energy is minimum at this point, and a small displacement from this point results in a small bounded motion. If you will displace your particle, it will come back and it will oscillate like this, like this, like this. So it's a bounded motion and the particle will oscillate with a frequency. And these types of oscillations are known as small oscillation. Okay. The example of stable equilibrium is bar pendulum at rest. If there is a pendulum, bar pendulum, and it is at rest. Okay. And you will displace your bar pendulum, will oscillate through its mean position. So this is a stable equilibrium. Okay, so little bit information about your unstable equilibrium. So this position is unstable equilibrium. So you can also see here that the force is also zero here, because the slope of potential energy curve is zero here, right? And the potential energy is maximum. You can see in your figure, in your curve, that here at this point, the potential energy is maximum, and small displacement from this point results in unbounded motion. Means it will not going. It will not come back to this position. And the example, best example is rod standing on its one end. If there is a rod and which is standing on its end, what will happen if you push slightly this rod? It will fall. Okay, so it means it's the case of your unstable equilibrium. Yeah. So now we will see in the case of stable equilibrium, if your particle is doing small oscillations, then what will be the frequency of these stable oscillations? Okay, so if you displace your particle through this displacement, x naught is a displacement, okay, from the mean position, so you can expand the potential energy using Taylor's formula. What is the Taylor's formula? You know, in mathematics, in complex analysis, I think you already know this formula. So if you will expand your potential energy, okay, by using this small displacement x naught, so it will be like ux equals to u x naught plus du over dx x naught, x minus x naught, and third term is plus 1 upon factorial 2 d2u over dx square at x naught, x minus x naught to the power 2 whole square plus, and so on. So this is the mathematical expansion using Taylor's formula, right? So what we have already discussed in both equilibrium, that this du over dx is zero, means first derivative of your potential energy is zero. So put this is equals to zero. So what you will have, ux equals to ux naught plus the second term. Okay, we are neglecting all the higher order term because this displacement is very, very small. So the higher order terms will be very, very small. So this is the final potential energy. Okay, but how you can calculate? You can calculate that your potential energy will depend on this derivative. So how you can calculate your angular frequency of small oscillations? By using this results. Okay, so your angular frequency of small oscillation is under root d2u over dx square upon m at this position. When your x is equal to x naught, using this formula, you can find out the frequency. And this is the frequency of your small oscillations. So these types of problems based on these formulas are quite common in both NET and GATE examinations. Okay, so we will see, I try to cover the problems related to the topics I will cover. So this is from NET examination. Consider the motion of the classical particle in 1D double well potential. Vx equals to 1 upon 4, x square minus 2, ka whole square. If the particle is displaced infinitesimally from the minimum on the positive x-axis then. Okay, so this is a case of double well potential, but here you have potential energy and they are asking you, they are basically asking you about the angular frequency. Okay, you have to choose the correct option. Okay, so these are the options. Just check what are the options. The particle will execute simple harmonic motion in right well with w equals to omega equals to under root 2. So using these formulas, small oscillations, you have to find out the angular frequency, and then we will match what is the correct answer. Okay, and the particle is on the minimum position. It's on the minimum potential energy positions, means stable equilibrium. So your V potential energy is this. In order to calculate the value of the stable points, okay, the coordinates of your equilibrium points, you have to find the value of x, means you have to find the value of that x naught. So you have to differentiate this potential energy and put it equals to zero, because what is the condition of maximum and minimum in mathematics? You know, the first derivative of the term is zero, only then you can find out the coordinates which are responsible for this. Okay, so differentiate this term with respect to x and equate it to zero. So you will get two coordinates, two value of your x, zero and plus minus under root two. So now, in order to find out the minimum potential energy, what is the condition for minimum potential energy? That this term is greater than zero. So you have to calculate the double differentiation of this term. Okay, means del 2 u over del x square or del 2 v over del x square. And this is this. So at x equals to zero, the value is minus 2. Okay, and the condition is for unstable point, v should be maximum. So at x equals to plus minus under root 2, because your value of x is also plus minus under root 2, you are getting positive value, means your d2u over dx square is positive and 4, means it's maximum. Okay, so this is, okay, so these are the two things. Here the value is minimum, means minus 2, okay, and here the value is 4. So for v is minimum, it's a stable point, and when your B is maximum, it's unstable point. So what is the angular frequency? We will use the same formula, that omega naught equals to D2U over DX square upon M at X equals to X naught. And what is the condition? What is the X naught for you? For U, 4, 2, okay, plus minus under root 2. So we will put this formula, and M is 1 here. So our angular frequency is 2. Okay, so yeah. So what is the correct option? I think option 2. The particle will exhibit simple harmonic motion because it is displaced from its minimum position and with angular frequency this. So this is the correct answer. And in this way, you can calculate, you can solve such kind of problems. Okay, so now move to our second important topic, and which is from a special theory of relativity, and it's the basics of a special theory of relativity. So once you talk about the special theory of relativity, this equation comes in your mind. Okay, this is a famous Einstein relation, okay, energy mass equivalence relation, and this is E equals to mc square. Okay, so this is the origin and the we can say and the gist of the special theory of relativity, right? So it is the theory, the famous special theory of relativity was developed by Albert Einstein in 1905. And this theory explains how your space and time are linked. Okay. And it's this basically for the objects, only for the objects which are moving with a consistent speed. Okay. So this is a special theory of relativity. And what are the postulates of special theory of relativity? The postulates, the principles are that the laws of physics are invariant in all inertial frames of references. Okay, means all the laws of physics, okay, all the Newton's laws, all the basic laws of physics are invariant, means which they are not going to change in all inertial frames of references. In next slide, I will also discuss what are the inertial frame of references. Theek hai, means non-accelerating from frame of references. Okay. Second and important postulate is the speed of light in vacuum is the same for all observers, regardless of the motion of the light source or observer. Means if you are choosing different light source, okay, so there will be different kind of lights, okay, but you are using these light sources in vacuum. So it doesn't matter on the types of light source you are using. But in all the cases, your speed of light is always same. So this is the second and most important postulate of your special theory of relativity. So now, what are the frame of references, inertial frame of references and non-inertial frame of references? What are these frames? So basically, we can see inertial frame. If suppose there is a frame, okay, and we have an object, okay, and this object is either at rest or it is moving with some constant velocity and there is no external force acting upon the particle or object. So these types of frames are known as inertial frame of references. Okay, we are using these terms frame of references, so don't confuse with this. It's a general thing. Means suppose if you have a body, if you have a car, if you have any object, okay, and that object is basically two conditions. If it is at rest or maybe it is moving but with constant velocity. So this object, this frame is known as inertial frame of reference, right? So basically, they are following your Newton's first law. Okay. Example is a person inside a stationary car. Okay. The person is inside a stationary car. The car is not moving. The person is sitting there. So this is the ideal case of inertial frame of reference. And the non-inertial frame of reference is, it's quite opposite from inertial frame. A non-inertial frame is any frame where your some external force is working on it. Okay. Means an accelerating car pushes us back into the seat. Means we are now, here your person was sitting inside a stationary car, inside in inertial frame. But now suppose the car is moving. So what will happen? It will, if you are sitting inside the car, the car will push you back. Okay. So this is a case of non-inertial frame because there is some acceleration. Okay. There is some acceleration. You are not in rest or not moving with some constant velocity. So this is the non-inertial frame. Okay. So this image, this picture will give you the better idea about the inertial frames and non-inertial frames. So suppose this is your train. Okay. And in this train, there are two persons, P and Q, are sitting inside the train. And your train is moving with some velocity V in negative x direction, right? And there is a person outside the train, which is standing or sitting. Okay. So the person is at rest, right? This person is R. So for this person P, this person Q is also at rest, right? But for person R, this person Q is not at rest. It's traveling in negative x direction, means in the same direction as your train is moving, right? So what is the meaning? The inertial frame is also relative. How? You are confused. So I'm going to tell you, okay? You are confused that which should be the inertial frame. So I will give you the answer, best answer. Just remember this thing. When you are talking about the inertial frames of references or non-inertial frame of references, first, you need to assume an inertial frame for us, okay? Means if a frame is inertial frame, if it is at rest or moving with constant velocity with respect to our assumed inertial frame, means you are saying that P is inertial frame for Q. P is only inertial frame for Q, means we are assumed this Q as our reference inertial frame, okay? We are talking about in reference of Q. So Q ke liye, for Q, your P is inertial frame, right? And vice versa, for P, your Q is inertial frame. Okay, so first you need to assume a inertial frame. Okay, means reference. You have to choose a reference. So for P, your Q is inertial frame, and for Q, your P is inertial frame, right? But P is, this P is non-inertial frame for R, right? Here your reference is R, okay? So for R, your P is non-inertial frame because there is a relative movement between P and Q. If you are talking about R, so for R, your P is moving with velocity V, minus V. And if you are taking reference P, so for P, your R is moving in positive X direction, okay? So this is how you should remember, and you can analyze the what is the inertial frame and what is the non-inertial frame. Okay, guys. So your next topic, which is also from special theory of relativity, it's length contraction, means length contraction reduction. So suppose if a body, okay, whatever means a rod, a car, anything, if a body is traveling with a speed, and this speed is relative to the velocity of light, means this speed V is nearly equal, or we can say is of the order of C, means velocity of light. So the term special theory of relativity comes into picture. Okay. The condition is your V should be of the order of C. So what is the length contraction? If suppose your body, if you have an object or rod, we can say having length L naught. Okay. This is the proper length. Okay. So its length is some in stationary frame, which is not moving. And suppose L is the length in some moving frame of references. And this frame is basically moving with velocity V with respect to your stationary frame. So the new length in the moving frame L is related to this proper length L naught. Okay, and what is this? L equals to L naught 1 minus V square upon C square. This relation is also given by Einstein, right? So if suppose this is your particle, this is your object initially at rest. Okay, so if your velocity is now of the order of C, means it's basically 0.3 C. So you are increasing velocity. Now the particle is moving with some relative velocity of C. So this formula is telling you that then the length is contracted. So suppose your particle is moving in this direction, in X direction. So in this direction only, the size of particle is going to be reduced. Means suppose this is the diameter, diameter in X axis. So this size, this length is going to be reduced once you are increasing the velocity and you are moving with velocity V. So these are the two cases. Now see the third case. If you are further increasing your V, now your V is 0.66 C. So the length is again contracted. So this size, see the size, it's reduced. Okay. Again, what happens if your V is now 0.8 C, means greater than this term, it will further reduced. Means if your velocity is more nearly equal to your C, so the size is reduced, okay, from the initial size. And this contraction, this reduction in the size is only in the parallel direction of the velocity. Means there is no contraction in the perpendicular direction of motion. Means in this direction, in this direction. In all the cases, this diameter along y-axis is same. So this is the length contraction in STR, special theory of relativity. So the next thing is time dilation. Okay, in special theory of relativity, time is also not constant, it's dilated. Okay, so if we have two clocks, and these clocks are moving relative to each other, and they both measure time for an event in their respective frames. Okay, so the difference in their measure time is known as time dilation. Means suppose we have two frame, right? And one frame, second frame is moving. We have two frames, like we can say S frame and S dash frame. So your S dash frame is moving with velocity V with respect to S, right? And there is an event which is happening. And for this frame S, the time measured is supposed is delta T naught. And in frame S dash, the measure time is delta T. So this delta T is related to this delta T naught in this way. Means delta T is equals to delta T naught upon 1 minus V square upon C square. So this formula is also given by, experimentally given by Einstein. And this formula is telling you that this measure time is greater than this proper time interval. This time which was in the stationary frame is also known as proper time. So this time is dilated, means increased. So this is the time dilation. So I will tell you in this image, okay, it will give you the best understanding, clear picture. Okay, so suppose you have two clocks, one and two. This clock is standing on the road and it's not moving. Okay, so it's in a stationary position. But we have a second clock, and this clock is attached with some car. Okay, and this car can move with velocity V, right? So when this clock is also stationary, means suppose this car is also at rest. So at that time, you can see the time showing by both the clocks are same, right? But what happens when your car is moving with velocity V? So obviously we are saying that this clock is also moving. So you can clearly see there is some time difference between these two clocks. And what is the relation? What is the result? Result is that in moving clock, the time is slowed. The time is slowed down as compared to this. Means if an observer is in inertial frame, so determines that the clock in motion relative to that observer runs slower time than their than his own clock. Okay, means suppose if you also, I forget the name of some movie. If you are fond of Hollywood movie, so there is a Interstellar, something like that. So there is a clear picture about the special theory of relativity. Means if somehow you can travel with the relative velocity, means when your velocity v is nearly equal to the order of c. Okay, so if you will like go somewhere and you will come back, so you will see that you will spend lesser time than the other person which are on earth. Okay, so there is also a very famous experiment, twin paradox in classical mechanics, and it's very common topic. Okay, so if suppose you are a twin, okay, and you move somewhere in space with velocity v of the order of c, okay, and after spending 1 hour, 1 year in space, you come back to earth and your twin was also on earth, so you will see that you aged like 1 year, because you spent only 1 year in space, but your twin sister or brother will be will age like more than 10 years or something. So there is a time difference. Okay, so this is time dilation. If you move with velocity which is order of c, you will spend lesser time. So this is the time dilation. So now one more important topic from special theory of relativity, guys. This is relativity of simultaneity. This is also very important, and in 5 mark in NET examination, you can have questions based on this. Okay, alternate year. So what is the relativity of simultaneity? The point is that two separated events occurring at same time is not absolute. It depends on observer's frame. So see the image. See this image. Okay, suppose B and A, these are the two events, means two incident, and they are happening at same time t, but they are at different locations. Means the location for B, incident B is x2, and for this event or incident A, the position is x1. See, so we have a third person. Now, sorry, we have a person P which is situated in the inertial frames, in the same frame of A and B, and it is at rest. So it will observe, P will observe that both events A and B are happening at same time, but they are located at different positions. Okay, but this person, okay, so this person, one second guys, this person Q, which is situated inside a plane, and this plane is moving some velocity v. So this person is not in inertial frame of these three things, A, B and B. This is moving relative to this frame. So it will observe that the two events A and B are not happening at the same time. So this is the relativity of simultaneity, means two separated events occurring at same time is not absolute, means they are changing if we are in a moving frame. It depends on observer frames, means the frame which is moving or not moving. So now we will see how we can relate these two times. Okay, so the event A and B are simultaneous for person P, right? For P, but for Q they are not simultaneous. Okay, so the time difference between these two events observed by P and person Q is given by this relation, means your delta T time difference is basically V upon C square x2 minus x1, 1 upon V minus under root 1 upon V, 1 minus V square upon C square. So using this relation, you can find out the time difference observed by both the person. So this is very, very important in special theory of relativity. So let us see a problem based on this principle. It's also from NET exam, guys. Yes?
Can you explain one more time the previous slide, ma'am?
Yeah, no issue. Okay, guys. So, yeah. Okay. So the thing is that in, I think someone is using annotation. Let me One minute, guys. Just 1 minute, guys. Yeah. So the principle is that in relativity of simultaneity is that two events which are occurring at same time is not absolute. Means it depends on the observer's frame. So suppose you have two incidents, anything. Okay. So they are basically be named A and B. Okay. And these two events are located at these locations. Means B is at X2 and A at X1. Okay. And this is the person P, which is in the same frame of AB. Means if these events are at rest, so P is also at rest. Okay. P is not moving. So for person P, the two events are happening at same time. Okay, so now we will see our person, second person, which we can see this person. So this person Q is basically sitting inside a plane, this plane, and this plane is moving with velocity V, okay, relative to this thing. So this is non-inertial frame, because this frame is moving, this person is moving with respect to this person and these events, okay. So this person observe that these two events are not happening simultaneously, means there is some time difference. Okay. Maybe this event is happening before the event B. So this is the case, means the events are not simultaneously happening for both these persons. So this is the formula, and using this formula, we can calculate the time difference between these two events, means this person Q will observe that these two events will be differ by this time. Okay, guys?
Yes, ma'am. Clear, ma'am.
Okay, great. So let's see the example. Two events separated by a distance 9 into 10 to the power 9 meter are simultaneous in one inertial frame. The time interval between these two events in a frame which is moving with constant speed 0.8 c, where c is, you all know, 3 into 10 to the power 8 meter per second is. So what you are going to calculate? The same thing, the time difference. So what you have? You have the difference, this difference x2 minus x1, this difference you have between the two events, 9 into 10 to the power 9 meter. And you have also the speed, the constant speed of the moving frame. Okay. V is all of the order of C, 0.8 C. So they are asking to calculate the time difference between the events in moving frame. Means they are asking delta D. What is the delta T? And you will use the same formula we just mentioned in the last slide, this formula. So you know your V is 0.8 C, you know the x2 minus x1 value, this value, you know this thing, just calculate and you will get 40 seconds. Means your option 2 is correct option. Okay, got it. See, you just need to remember the formula and you can calculate the right answer. So this is all about today's class. So if you guys have any query, you can ask. But before that, I will do also... you have any query, guys, so far?
No, ma'am.
Okay, so let me show you.
Ma'am, one request.
Yes, please.
Can you send those slides to our email account?
No problem. We will send you. Okay, so let me show you the website. Okay. You can also find the courses. Okay, so on our website now, there is so much free content available. So you can check our website. Let me show you. So we have these courses. Some courses are free, okay, and some are paid. So you can go there. And we have some test series also. Okay, so we have also some test series. like online test series for general aptitude section and few other papers like this. So you can check, okay? You can check these courses, okay? Quantum mechanics, nuclear and atomic, and these courses, classical mechanics, we have on our website. And in you can check all the question papers of CSIR NET GATE, okay? And in this section material, you can check books based on the syllabus of this NET and GATE examination. You can download the PDF from there. Sample papers we have already on our website. And these papers, we have the important topics of these papers. Like in classical mechanics, we have these three topics, full explanation of these topics, okay? And also, one more thing, okay? And you can check, these are the courses, okay? So you can go and check and download the content from there, okay? And in case of any problem you are facing, so you can just tell me. So these are the topics, like you can check any topic, and these are very, very informative topics based on the syllabus of these examinations, right? So yeah, like this. Okay, so, and also, yeah. So we have this section, and guys, let me tell you, if you are interested in online coaching, you can like check on our website. We have so many courses, and initially, the payment, the total fee for the course was 599, but it's reduced for a few days, and you can join if you want to join, because we have already classes running. Okay, so you can get this total course in 5000 rupees. Okay, and we have I mentioned here only three, but we have five instructors here. Okay, and all are experienced, all are NET qualified and GATE qualified. So if you are interested and if you want to join our online classes, so you can also register here, okay? And in case of any material, any books, anything you want to ask, you can just email us, okay? For any question, you have any query, any question based on the topic we covered or about the classes or anything?
No, I have a question. Hello.
Yes, please.
Okay. The 5000 rupees is for the whole course, right? Classical mechanics, quantum mechanics, all of them, right?
Yeah. Yeah. But it's not a, we can say, full length course. It's basically 2 month course. Okay. Means more than crash course. And in because it's only in 5000 rupees, and second, we are targeting the December examination and February GATE examination. So it's basically 2 months course, and in this course we will have 100 to 120 hours whole lectures, means so for each paper around 12 hours content will be there. So in this we will cover all the important things, all the little basic and more advanced things. Previous year's problems, all the concepts, tricks, quizzes, regular quizzes, assignments, and also online test series after the completion of each paper. And we have five instructors, okay? And they will teach you different papers. So, and in January, we will start full length course, okay? Means 4 to 5 months course will be there. Okay, so any other
questions? What is the, 1 minute.
Yes,
madam. What is the fee structure for the full length course of 5 months or 6 months?
It's basically it's not actually figured out yet by the all the sir, because I may but I will tell you, it's 14 to 15,000 rupees for the whole full length course, which is more than 4.5 months. Okay, and in this course you will be like all the basics, each and every topic from your syllabus will be covered, quizzes, assignments, and so many online test series will be there, okay? And five instructors. So for reference now, you can do one thing, you can check us on YouTube also. We have already so much content available there. So you can get an idea about the content we provide. And also on our website, you have free courses, some free courses you can check. Okay. And so you will get an idea about the quality we will give you. Okay. So for any other confusion, you can contact us anytime. And we have also pre-recorded videos. If you are interested, like you are searching for short course, okay, like as I have said, you 100 to 120 hours course. So you can also go for pre-recorded videos. Okay. Any other confusion, guys?
Thank you.
Okay. You want to ask something? Okay. No issue. Thanks, everyone. Thanks.
Thank you.
Yeah, bye.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.
Thank you.